Thank you, Madam Chair. I thank everybody on the panel for being here, for staying with us so long, and for your incredibly compelling and important testimony on the topic of today's hearing. Mr. Shelton, you talked about convergence of interest, and I think that's a really important point to emphasize. As you were saying that, I was recalling that the HEPA, which is American Hellenic Education and Progressive Association, so that's the largest and most active organization in the country that represents interests of the Greek American community. It was formed in the South in response to Klan activity that was directed at Greek Americans back in the 1920s and 1930s. So that convergence of interests is very directly bearing on that. But all of these communities that that we're speaking about today have that convergence of interest. And clearly there's two very important responses that we need to have when these incidents of hate speech, anti-religious, racial incidents occur, acts of violence. One is to show an immediate sense of solidarity in responding to it. The other is to take very practical steps to try to protect against these attacks. And I think we're bringing important focus in the Congress to both of those things. But if I could go back to the solidarity element for a moment. Often our concept of solidarity is reactive. In other words, something occurs and then we assemble a kind of unified coalition response to that to condemn it. And obviously that's an important thing to do. What that seeks to overcome is human nature, because when an incident occurs, the immediate reflexive human response is to think, am I part of the group that was attacked, or am I not part of the group? And if you weren't part of the group, the specific group that experienced the pain or the attack, your reflex is in a sense, relief. You momentarily set yourself apart. That's a difficult thing to overcome. But we need to get to a place where this convergence of interest concept is so deep and abiding that if any particular subgroup within our community and our society feels pain or is attacked, that we feel it regardless of whether we are part of that group. And what I wanted to ask anyone to comment on is what opportunities do you see, or activities underway that are knitting together this sense of solidarity sort of at the ground level, on the front end, if you will, so that when the attack occurs, the broad community feels it in that instant, rather than there being that kind of delayed response, which is important, but is a delayed response. So maybe you could speak to, in Pittsburgh and other places, where different communities are aligning with each other, creating coalitions so that they feel equally these attacks, regardless of which group it's directed at.
I think that's a very important point. When the attack happened in Pittsburgh, what happened prior to the attack, we have a community relations council. Our community relations council director in Pittsburgh spends time with all faith-based groups. That's his job. And he convenes an interfaith committee. We talk to different groups. And when the attack happened in Pittsburgh, it was instantaneous. We had every faith-based group, African-American, Muslim, Christian groups surrounding us in Pittsburgh. That didn't happen by chance. That happened by that interfaith community working together. And we felt that through the community in Pittsburgh right away. We had a Muslim group working with us, and quite frankly, they were one of the first groups that donated money to the Victims of Terror Fund. And it was heartening to see that. But that work was done prior to that shooting.
Gentleman's time has expired. Thank you so much.